You are engaged in shooting after the COVID. You are making a sequel of Village Roxa. And Rima is accompanied by one of our stars of Village Roxa. Could you kindly introduce him?
Yeah, Bolo, Bolaram Das. He.
Mask.
He acted in Village Roxa. And actually, he's very much interested in acting. So we developed bonding during the time of shooting, and he's a family now. And he's also acting in my other two films, Village Roxa sequel, and I'm making one more film, and he's acting in that film also. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, Bobo, and I'm really, really happy to be here and meeting you all. And this is like after, I think, more than a year, and coming out, and it's really overwhelming to be here.
You're most welcome. Before we begin, a slight disclaimer on my side. In between the conversation, I might cough a bit, but this is my allergic reaction to because of my asthma condition, and this is not because of COVID. Thank you. As you have already said yesterday, so many things, and you have also said so many things through your film, and I believe you have spoken so much through your expressive art, and I think, but still, there is something which remains, which we can, you know, kind of chat out when you sit down like this together in a room like this with a very few people around us. I shall try to pick up from where we left yesterday when you spoke with Sonia and Abram. I haven't come honestly prepared with what to talk or what to ask to you. I haven't come with a notebook or a pen, but I've just come to plunge into a kind of atmosphere where Rima is really good in, you know, in trying to react with spontaneity, with your intuition. That's how you told us yesterday, how you build up your rapport with your actors. That's really wonderful as a storyteller. So I shall begin with what you have said yesterday, that the film, your second film, Village Roxa, has changed your life. So if I may ask, who was Rima Das then, and who is Rima Das now?
It's quite interesting question. Also made me thinking. I'm also not prepared, and yesterday I was wondering, like, I don't know what I'm going to say today or yesterday, because it's after a long time actually I'm attending such event, and for everyone it has been tough this year. So yes, so before Village Roxas, I think I feel like I was just a little child and just fall in love with cinema, because I already mentioned that I always wanted to be an actor. And when in Mumbai I got opportunity to watch world cinema, then it just came to my mind that probably I don't know about the technical things, but I could tell story, like that is what it came to my mind. So before Village Roxas, I made one feature film, but still somehow that time I was not sure, I was not confident what I was doing. But when I started the journey of Village Rockstars, and because I was almost alone with these children, then it is the whole film was like a film school for me. It was a explorative journey for me, and I was just experimenting. I was free. I didn't know much, but only whatever I learned watching movies, and then I just followed my intuition. So I didn't know that it's going to work or not. I was just exploring, you know, the nature, lights, and bonding with my characters, that space, sound, everything. And without knowing, like, given myself, and it changed my life, because I was living a very limited life, you know, in Mumbai. And when I made my first film, that time also it was limited. I had a crew, so I had to follow, you know, like the way regular movies mostly they make with a crew. So I had to follow those rules. But here I was free, like when I was making Village Rockstars. So then when it came to the world, you know, like when I started sending to Work in Progress, then people started responding, and it was different from my first feature film. And like everyone loved it, and so that gave me enough confidence. So if you ask me where I am now, it's like it's that it gives me happiness that I tried something. And that time I was like totally like a child. I was curious, and I unlearned myself in that process. So everything was unknown to me, and then today I'm happy that world accepted that, you know, that so that gives me immense like happiness that wow, I tried something and it just really worked. So yes,
can you be a bit more precise when you say unlearn? What did you unlearn when you get exposed to world cinema? Your priority was acting. After you got exposed to world cinema, then you want to become a storyteller. Before answering that question, tell me quickly, would you still like to act in a movie?
I do sometimes, but when you are directing something and I'm taking so many roles, it's not only writing and directing, but I'm doing other things also, editing, like cinematography, production, everything. So then it's more and more pressure on me, actually. So if I want to act, then I have to free myself again. I have to go through that process. So if I can, then only. Otherwise, somehow I feel like I'm not ready to act, but I want to also. So I'll see, maybe after this year, then.
So please share your thoughts. What was that unlearning process? What do you actually unlearn to plunge into such powerful storytelling? Because that is always a trapping in the sense our consciousness has been dominated knowingly or unknowingly by this, you know, the strong audiovisual medium is everywhere today. And there is another popular way of telling stories, very popular. But how do one get out of their trappings, to tell your own story with such belief and with such courage? And what was that unlearning process?
Just organic. It's not that I tried hard. I think being in my village, connecting with my roots, being with the children especially, he's sitting here today. So being with them helped me. Being with the villagers and being in nature, I think it helped me. It was not intentional. It was just process. It was just because I was living in Mumbai from long time. So you adopted something or other unknowingly. Then when you are back, then I realized I lost myself somewhere in the crowd. Then you feel like you born again. So that what happened in my life. I felt like I'm like a child, you know, I'm free. I don't need to fear anything. I just love cinema and I just need to do it. It's just like I'm not here to prove anyone. I love it and I'm just doing it, you know. Whatever I see, what I see, like the images I see, I just need to, I should try to just create. So that's how we did it, and the process was also organic. I'm saying under the sky, and no one bothered, you know, like, and the actors, because they are non-professional, didn't question me. You know, there was no doubt in their eyes. So when I was making my first film, I felt like it was a small crew, but I felt like they asking me like what you are doing, you know, that thing sometimes kills you if they don't trust you. But when I was making Village Rocksters, they were kids, mostly children, so they trusted me. And they also didn't know, like, what is cinema, you know. So that, I think, helped me to unlearn. So it was, although it was not intentional, it was just a process, and definitely I was enjoying it myself. So, yeah, that's it, I think.
And briefly, how did you stumble into world cinema, being there in the Temptation Island? Mumbai is a Temptation Island, where there is strong temptation to become rich and famous overnight, to earn a lot of money, to earn fame, to become somebody. In that milieu, how did you stumble into world cinema?
That was also, I think, destined somehow, because I was doing theater also that time. So I met friends and then they introduced me. And that time it was very hard to like find it, not available. And then I remember one guy, he was there in Mumbai. He used to sell DVDs. Yes. So then I bought few. And I really like, for me, because I grew up watching Bollywood films, so somehow I was fascinated totally. I thought, okay, this is how also, you know, you can make cinema. So mostly in the beginning, I was watching more Iranian films, then also from India, Satyajit Ray. So then I thought, okay, I can also make like movies. You don't need the large, like that big budget for just to make cinema. Then that time, 2009, I made a short film. I was back in my village and I made a short film just to know, okay, let's see, let's explore. Then that film got selected in 2-3 festivals. That boosted my morale. I think that boosted, like, then that was the beginning.
Would you be happy to call your two works particularly, Village Rockstar and Bulbul Can Sing, as world cinema? We want an honest answer.
Yes, I think because they accept it, so I can, it is like, I think so, yes.
And we agree so.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure.
Rima had mentioned about creative freedom, creative space, the kind of freedom you want. Because your working style is totally different from, I know everyone has a different style, different approach. But if I may ask, what is freedom to Rima Das?
What is freedom to Rima Das? I'm still wondering, you know, every month, you grow, you just exploring. I feel like I don't know myself, you know. I know so much, sometimes I feel like I know so much, but next day I feel like I don't know anything, you know, like life gives you surprises, and that's how life is. So I forgot even your question, what you asked me. Freedom, right?
What is freedom to Rima Das?
What is freedom for me is when you don't feel any pressure, no thoughts like troubling you, you know. If you are there, you feel calm, you just calm, and you are at peace, you are doing, and I think that's freedom for me, you know. You just, you are there, and there is nothing is bothering you. That is freedom for me, you know. And there is no time limit, there is no outer pressure, no control. And even your mind, it sometimes is not the outer pressure. We feel like, oh no, like other people are bothering you or trying to control, or that environment or the situation. It's not like that. It's our own mind. You know, it's all about, like, during this pandemic time, and I got time to talk to myself, because last four or five years I was busy making movies and then traveling and talking to people, but this year I got more time for myself, and then I realized that more than the outer world, it's your mind, you know. It doesn't allow you to be free. All the time some thoughts keeps coming to your mind, so I'm trying to get away, you know, how I can, our feelings are different, and what you are actually is different, you know. These feelings, it keeps coming and going, but what actually you are is more important. So I'm trying to be there, you know, trying to know myself better, because I feel sometimes, okay, some just situation comes, arise, and it's challenging. So it's your mind, I think. I want
but
to
then,
be free.
But then, hypothetically, if a big international film production company agrees to finance you and work with you, with your film, would you think your space of freedom will be curtailed if you work?
In a way, yes, also. But yesterday also I mentioned that when I am working alone, then I have other limitations, and also it's a lonely journey, I said, sometimes, not always, but I want to explore that too. I already did last year two films. It's a short film, one short film and a documentary with crew, and this time also I'm working with a small crew, and I want to make big films and the big black crew. That will be different experience. I want to explore that also. Yes, because sometimes you visualize, your images are different, and it's not possible for me because I'm not actually a cinematographer, so I cannot create that image in my mind. So then I need help. And then there are people who are experts. They're good, and I would love to collaborate with them and create those kind of images and visuals. I love visuals, good visuals. Like, so sometimes I feel limited. So yeah, yes.
Yes, yesterday you mentioned something which really didn't go down well with me personally, to be honest. You said you would like to go back to a film school to learn the craft of storytelling. But I think your work has defied all norms of storytelling that are being taught in film school. But you still want to go back to film school and learn.
I want to go. I just want to take courses like on cinematography especially. Direction, I think it's a very individual, very subjective, but the cinematography, yes, I want to go. And I want to be with that kind of circle, so I just want to experience. Or maybe I want, it would be great to assist the great directors if I get opportunity. Yeah, that's what I want to do.
Alright. Now, coming to your character, Bulbul, when you visualize this character, I think a slice of Premadas has been invested into the character, if I'm wrong, Bulbul. Because Bulbul is a fighter. She believes in fighting back. She may not be a loud fighter. She may not be an agitated fighter. But she believes in questioning things, she believes in defying things, and she wants to see the world in her own way. So, if I may say, while you visualize this character called Bulbul, a slice of Premadas has been invested in Bulbul.
It's always, I think, it's art is a reflection of your own life, or somehow you are there, you cannot separate your art from yourself, it's difficult. So when now since I have made the 3 films, then when I'm now also making, then I feel like sometimes am I making the same films again and again? It also comes to my mind. It's although they are different, but very similar. Am I creating same images again and again? If you are talking about Bulbul now, then I cannot also separate myself from Village Rockstar's Dhunu. You know, so
nice.
So I'm there somehow, where I don't know which character. It's not only Bulbul. I think in the same film, I'm there in I have similarities with Bulbul, maybe with Bonnie also, maybe with that Suman's character also, maybe that Pakija Begum who played that role, Bonnie's mother, maybe
she's a wonderful actor.
I'm there also, so it's difficult, and I don't like, I just when I'm writing, when I visualize my character, I tried to be, you know, neutral. I tried to be detached from my character. But somehow or other, I feel like you are there.
Yeah, let me come back to that. How do you manage to detach? It's really not easy, said and done. And I mean, it's really difficult how one detaches from the character that she built herself. How is that process really possible?
It is, because it's like we have opinions about everything, you know. Maybe it's we have political opinions, we have social, we are a social person, like we are living in a society. So from our childhood, we have opinions, you know. So when you are making your films, those characters, although I am writing, although, you know, I am creating those characters, but still they are not me. So, and also then I started thinking about from their point of view. Then sometimes intentionally I put my opinions through their voices, you know, through the dialogues, but still I keep myself detached. So that it's because what Bulbul is saying, it is Bulbul's, I just need to research, like, where she's coming from, what kind of family, you know, that what is her background, everything. Then only I can portray her authentic way. Like, I cannot put myself there because my family is different, the way I grew up different, you know. So, yeah. So, for every character, I go to their background. Like if I'm giving them dialogues also, I'm very careful. I need to be very careful. So for that, you really need that observation, you know. Like, so I like to spend time with them. If I'm writing it, it cannot be just superficially, like, bring that character. Yes.
Can you imagine your stories without the village background?
Yes, I can.
Can you?
Yes, because being in Mumbai, and also I studied in Guwahati, so yes, but definitely I love to create something more in villages, but I'm in future probably I'll make movies in Mumbai. And I like where when I know the people and I'm there. So if in short period of time, if I don't know the people and that place, then I don't feel comfortable to create. So I have to be there for a long period to understand, you know, then only I can.
Rima also mentioned yesterday that nothing much have changed in the village you grew up. The kind of atmosphere, the kind of outlook has not changed since
not
today.
Not really, but lots of things have changed also. But we have certain norms and rules, and it's not changed.
Do you think after showing your Bulbul can sing to that particular village, does it have an impact to the villagers in their worldview, in their belief system?
It's a process, actually. It's a process. And when I'm with these children, when I'm in my village, sometimes I try to... it's not educate them, but sharing my knowledge, whatever I have learned. But I have realized that it should be in that person, you know. If that person wants to learn and wants to grow, then only it's possible. They should be open-minded. And things have changed, no doubt. But it's a process. You have again and again, you have to hit them. You have to, like, you know, like, be with them. Otherwise, they can easily forget also. So, it's not easy. It's not that easy. But in Village Rock, in Bulbul Can Sing, one character is I picked up from real life. That's Suman's character. Mm-hmm. So when I was making my first feature film in that village, that time only I noticed that in my village, everyone, like elders, children, they call him like ladies, you know, because he has that feminine characteristics, so they used to call him ladies. Then I felt really bad, and I could like feel that he is not comfortable. So he is a real character, but after this movie, now I can see that even the children and the villagers, they don't talk to him like that. And he, it was really interesting, and I was really happy that he got Best Actor Award in Assam, then also Singapore. So that also, that changed, I think, his life. So that's a big change for me.
Now allow me to take a little diversion from our dialogue, and let me ask you quickly, what comes to Rima Das's mind when the word Northeast, when you heard the word Northeast, what comes to Rima Das's mind?
Northeast?
Yes.
Northeast is beautiful, it's heaven, you know, like I'm traveling to so many places, and then always I want to come back home. And I couldn't come earlier, but this time when I just got the invitation, that time only, just I always wanted to come to Manipur. I want to visit, and it's I don't have any word to explain. And I think we have so much like potential and possibilities, so we just keep up, I think, that energy, and we can create wonders.
The purpose why I've asked this question is, yes, do you believe in something like Northeast poetry, or Northeast poetry, or Northeast literature, or Northeast cinema? Can you deduce the artwork here as something Northeast, give a title, a label as Northeast? Because a Manipuri poetry is different from Assamese poetry. Somewhere there may be similarities. A Manipuri cinema maybe is quite different from Assamese cinema, though the language may be the same. But I think as an artist, I am not really comfortable with this labeling of, you know, in major festivals like, allow me, in even in MIF, you have this Northeast section, you know. The Northeast section screening is going on, then Kashmir section is going on. How can you identify, or how can you put into a block called Northeast? Because we are making cinema. What I may say, it's a regional cinema, but do you really feel comfortable with this labeling of any work, artwork, as the Northeast cinema, or the Northeast poetry, or the Northeast song?
I think that only this is like the system is doing that, you know. Individually, I don't feel like I am under that level. Like when I made, when I'm making cinema and my films traveling, that time I never felt like that. So it's just a label, I think, created by people, you know. And when from even people from our country, you know, different parts of our country, they are watching our films, if Pavan's films and my film or any film from Northeast, they are not labeling our films like, oh, this is a Northeast film or this. They are just watching it as a film. You know, they are
absolutely agree with that. Just to inform you, we have another dialogue in the days to come with Northeast, if I may use the word Northeast again. This particular celebration we have, the organizers have purposely decided to invite friends from the Northeast, from Nagaland, from Assam, from Tripura, because we believe in building up a cohesive dialogue among the artists, among the storytellers. Not necessarily that to go with the norms of homogenization, but we believe in our individual voice and respecting each other's voice and knowing each other more through screenings of films here in this such kind of occasion. And now, if I may throw to the audience, if you have some queries, Briefly, please introduce yourself, and please be brief in your question, and in, or whether it's an observation or the question.
Hello, Rima.
Hi.
I am Amar Maivam, and I'm also one of the filmmakers from here. So it's really nice to witness your film last night.
Thank you.
So I want to know regarding the funding of your film, because you are already funded by some of the Chinese institute, I think, production house, Chinese Sparrows or Asian Set or something like that. So can you brief a little bit about how, like, we are also facing the same problem with a lot of filmmakers regarding the funding and how to reach out to the audience, because cinema halls are dying right now here at Imphal and many places in the country. So can you explain a little bit more about the new option or a new platform? Thank you.
Thank you. With me, if I, it's better that I share only my experience. So in the beginning with my first film, it's a funded, my till now, like till Bulbul Can Sing, all my films are, it's a small budget film. So during the shooting of the film, I didn't spend much. With Village Rocksters and Bulbul, so there was not even a crew. So it's my own camera I bought, and that's how we made it. And so during the post-production only we spent some money. I didn't compromise with post-production, so I spent some money. And with Village Rocksters, there are working progress lab around the world. And honestly speaking, to crack those lab and get an award is also not very easy. Because if it is in China, they like to promote more their filmmakers, you know. And there are also co-production market. If you are, you want to shoot your film in other countries, then they fund your films. And with me, Village Rockstar, it was in half Hong Kong film finance society, and that I got an award, and it was just they did that color correction. That's it. And they have also award monies, but that is what I'm saying. It is, it's not that easy. They prefer to give their filmmakers sometimes, but you have to keep trying. You have to keep trying. And now, because after the success of Village Rocksters and Bulbul, now other producers approaching me, so then it become easier. And it's better, I think, if we can create, you know, like that kind of infrastructure here. We cannot stop making movies. So we have our cinematographers, we have editors, we have, I think it's better to, I think, create that bonding with like-minded people. I when I met Village Rocksters and Bulbul, I was doing almost everything, like only the sound design and the color correction someone else did, but otherwise like editing, cinematography and other things also I was doing. But sometimes it's, for everyone is not, probably not comfortable. So then I think you should connect with like-minded people. There are so many now here after this digital filmmaking, like that revolution, like so many are there, you know, they are good. I think you should make your movies and then you send it to festivals, or it's not like if you are making an independent filmmaker, independent films or a commercial film, or like somehow then who are your audience? You know, if it should have also market values, but then also like if you are not comfortable, if you are, you really want to make just an independent art films, then also it's fine. It all depends on you. But till the time, honestly, it's how to say it, what I have realized, and talking to my friends who are also filmmakers around the world, if you prove it, and if the producers, they come to know that, okay, it's a marketable films, then only they are interested to produce your films. That's the truth, bitter truth. But that's how it works. Otherwise, now the OTT platforms, now is very difficult the time to release your films. But if they are taking like a film for OTT platforms, then also they that research that, okay, this like audience, are they are like accepting. So, but you should not lose hope, I think. You should keep trying with the limited resources, that's it, and then it opens window. So, and even I have few friends from out of India, and life is, for independent films, is difficult. It's not easy. But that doesn't mean that we stop making movies, right? So you keep exploring. There are working progress labs. There are, and we have few filmmakers that their films got funded, but sometimes partially probably. And I just wish you, I can, like, best wishes to you. Just keep doing it.
Yeah, just to...
That's how it, because they came to know that it was Village Access was awarded in so many festivals, then it was premiered in Toronto, it got best feature film like in India National Award and Oscar entry. So because of that, you know, and if your film is not also traveling, if it has that market values, then they are going to take it. There are many films. It's not that they are traveling to festivals, but they are taking it because audience are watching those kind of films. So it's like they know that we have large consumers. You know, if there are consumers for your films, then they will take it.
Just to add a bit, hello, Pabban's article in our souvenir, I believe it would open some windows to film marketing and co-production, because he has shared his experience working with and traveling to different film bazaar. So I think it will be quite useful for filmmakers, independent filmmakers.
Yeah. So as a new filmmaker, it is better to go to send your films to film market, NFDC. That is the only good platform in India, I think. Yeah, then you can meet really few good people, and that's it, I think.
Yeah, I shall take the liberty to call out names and point out people who should ask questions, because I know they really want to, and I know many of them. I would pass on the mic to Oza Nilotpal, our dada here, who has been the centripetal force of the young people here around. He has been our Oza, our teacher, and I think he has lots to ask, but please pick a few.
thank you, and I really want to talk a lot, but it is not a kind of a forum where I will have such time. Rima, I'm really your great fan, you know, because you helped me to revisit my childhood, you know, the way I grew up. And I also see that you possibly have grew up in the same way. Although I didn't grow up in a village, it was a semi-suburb, refugee colony, and the distant suburb of Calcutta. But people came from Bangladesh and they actually brought the village, the sensibility of a kind of a rural Bengal with them. And I lived there, and I still remember when I was going for school living exam, that urban space was really, really a village, you know. And what the magical thing is that, because I think you lived that life, although you were in Bombay, you are coming back. Honestly, this is so pure, and this is so authentic, you know, and at the same time, very magical. I give an example that when Bonnie committed suicide or passed away, you know, and how her body was discovered, and how villagers were responding. The child, I think, dipped in the water and passed away. It's the death of a child, you know, daughter of the village, you know. I have seen in my life, there are at least 9 to 10 children, actually. There are big, big ponds, you know, they died. So only you have experienced that. It's a fabulous moment, you know, in the film, you know. How the villagers started crying, screaming, and eventually they reached to the courtyard. And then we see mom responding, you know, which is possibly the loudest moment of the scene, a film. But at the same time, it's so genuine, so authentic. The grain is so real to the kind of space, that social space and emotional space. You know. On the other hand, we see the same people fight when the cow grows for grazing, you know. And after that, we see that. So there's a small, small thing you really fight. We have jealousy, we have a kind of our indifferences, but at the same time, a kind of an incredible bonding that society live in. That's why everybody is with the hand fan, you know, trying to, and says, don't worry that she has gone, but we are with you, you know. That's how all, this is the thing. So this is something that is possible. It's not rural Bengal, it's not rural Assam, you know. It's Manipur, it is India that way, South Asia, you know. You are revisiting that, and it really reminds me that it's a pure literary experience. When I saw the village rockstar, I found it's literature, you know. Again, when I see it, it's a really, really, to me, that I'm revisiting great literature, particularly Bengali literature, which is incredibly great in terms of not creating plot point in the narrative, not creating events in the narrative, but observe life, you know. It's a kind of with a meditative kind of an engagement, you know, and life flows on, you know. So your film talks about that. Like the Kirtaniyas are singing, you know. It's opium for me, you know. It's magic, you know. There's a dang, 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 dang. So their engagement, all, you know, it's all great, you know. And that's why I think this is a speciality. So don't go to film school and try to learn cinematography. I think when you start articulating it, it might fall down. I don't know. It's my idea about what I've seen. Possibly when you make a film on the urban space, you know, you will be coming out with a kind of a same kind of a skill and kind of a sensibilities. But like, one thing I tell you, why it might be really, it will hurt me. Like, when the fighting with the cow grazing, suddenly your camera becomes handheld and you go into kind of a little close-ups, and you try to get into the kind of that dynamism of the kind of a conflict. But I imagine that instead you're trying to dynamize and touch upon the kind of a spirit of conflict. You are a little distantiated. Look as you normally are looking at life at your village. It would have been little, for me, much more magical and exciting. At the same time, sometimes I see in Bulbul, you know, sometimes, you know, you frame her like Vaidya Rehman, you know, with a close-up, you know, with a little top angle, light falling like that, hair is like this, and 2-3 times, you know, that somehow, this kind of articulation appears to be beautiful, but it the kind of grain and the kind of truth that you touch upon, somehow it was disturbing for me to see such beautiful close-up and beautiful angle, which is extremely articulated, you know. I would have loved to really move it out from your film, because your film talks about something absolutely different. That's why in fact I say even in places that what Reema is doing is actually totally relooking at the particularly fiction narrative, you know, and evolving a new language, you know. That language you don't find a kind of has a certain kind of tenets or kind of intent. It is unintended spontaneity, that exactly that possibly that is in our mind, you know, what we have experienced, you know, which is so pure, you know. I told really so much about it, but these are the two or few things that I, and I asked you about the goat, you know. But this is something that you do, which is your speciality, you know. It really makes me think a lot, you know, because somehow we manufacture story. We don't look at our life. We try to always think of a story and really struggle to find out what story would be. But in your case, as if it really comes up, like your landscape, either your ponds, you know, your rivers, you know, when it is flooded, you know, the leaves, you know, and birds, you know, and insects, all these things, and they're humans. Like father was beating up, and you, camera was out from the baranda, and mother suddenly rushed in, and mother was trying to hold husband, and trying to protect the daughter. This simple, but that is possibly exactly it happens, you know. And that is the thing, that it's the reality that you are not manufacturing. It is reality you are not reconstructing. So in your reconstructive storytelling, you somehow, you get into the kind of a normal, which is so spontaneous, so original. That's what actually magical. That's why when you talk about little bit of compositions and all, I see, and it doesn't gel with your kind of the language that you have evolved, you know. And thank you for that, you know. It's something great that we found out after a long time. You know.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think I have to talk to you more because I'm also learning, because sometimes I don't know, you know, like maybe it was not intentional, but whatever you felt, it's important for me. And I'll share my work in future, and I'll talk about it then, probably.
Next it's question,
for
please.
Me, yes, still it's a learning process. Thank you so much.
Ritu?
Hello, Reema.
Hi, hi.
My name is Ritu. Like Oja said, I'm also a big fan of yours. I found great resonance when you said that sometimes it's not the outside world that becomes an intrusion in your creative freedom, it's your own mind. So as somebody who's finding her own way, I've just started my journey in documentary filmmaking, and I think this may be a personal question to you as well. You spoke about that, but then you just trailed off. But as someone who saw your cinema finding its own rightful place in the world, how did you make peace with your mind, or how did you convince yourself that you can, you know, see the end of your film and reach where it has reached?
Sorry, can you repeat?
I'm talking about, you spoke about your mind being your own limitation sometimes in the creative field, or curtailing your own creative freedom. But then having seen your film reach the places where it has reached, or where they have reached, how did you convince your mind to do that?
How did you build up your own mind? Yesterday you also mentioned about the base and the most difficult part is to convince yourself. So if, I believe her question is somewhat related with that. The inward gaze you take when you go through the process of convincing yourself, how do you go about it?
How I go? It's all about you, you know, just like it's your own choices. Just I keep talking to myself, and that peace, what freedom for me, what peace for me, for you maybe it is different, you know. Now I am living in a joint family, and we are then for with my brothers, their peace and my peace is different, you know. So you only know, like, it just, I cannot tell for yourself what gives you peace, what gives you freedom or happiness. So you have to find it, you know. So for that I take help also. I take help from nature. I take help from looking at the other people. So I look back in like my past, what is happening now. So it's a process. So it's nothing hard and fast rules, but it just it's organic again. You every day you discover yourself. So when I was in Bombay, when I was back in my village, started making movies, then I felt something different about myself. Then I felt, oh no, like I was for so long I was disconnected, you know, like so I don't know I'm able to answer your question, but it's very subjective. Now people ask me after all the success how you feel, you know, like sometimes I feel different, sometimes I feel different, you know, like every day is different for me. You know, every day is a new day. Every film I have made, like Village Rocksters is Village Rocksters, it's success, it's like it's there, but it's Bulbul, but Bulbul success is there. But now when I'm making my next film, it's totally, everything is new, you know, all challenges, struggles, and creating that magic again, images is different. So if what I'm doing, my work, and it's a, you need to create that balance, you know, like where I am today as a person and my work. So it's a continuous process, and conflicts are always there, but how to overcome, then you just need to keep trying.
Yes. I think the bottom line is to move on, whatever it takes. I think that's the bottom line. So can you have another question, please? Yes, Oza B.C. Kuman. Oza is a poet, he's a writer, and he's a regular commentator of events and things in the local newspaper.
Hello,
yes, Oza.
Hello, Rima. Yesterday was a very lucky day for me. I have heard about you, but I saw actually your film, very impressive, very appealing. And as sir has said, I have also a lot of things to say about your film, but time doesn't permit me today. At the same time, I'm not very conversant in English, so I'm afraid I may not be able to express whatever comes to my mind. Now, I'll just focus one or two things. Yesterday, at the very beginning, Napram Sonia was about to relate your film to feminists, kind of voices, but later on she dropped the idea because it is not exactly. She also understands that. So now my point is this: you are not trying to analyze the sexual morality from a feminist standpoint. Okay, you are not propagating a feminist voice. Everyone of us understand that. At the same time, you are not sticking to the traditional values. So my point is, perhaps you are trying to make a, you are trying to propagate a kind of synthesis, cultural synthesis. Okay, that is what I wanted to know from you. Are you personally, ideologically, believe in a kind of cultural synthesis? You see, nowadays there are hardcore modernists who always support whatever ultra-modernism, this and that, coming from the West, yes. And at the same time, there are conservationists, Puritans, who always stand against these modernist ideas. They want to retain, okay, our cultural values. But as an artist, I think that you want to strike a balance, a kind of cultural synthesis. Now let me explain why I come to this conclusion. Because, you know, yes, one thing I like about your film is you are using a lot of metaphors. Every scene, every, you know, images are all organically related to the main theme. Say, for example, relating to what I said, knowingly or unknowingly, you are trying to, give some preference of some, not wholly, I mean, sided with modernist ideas or traditional culture, some sort of synthesis, because you are respecting our cultural values at the same time. At the same time, you are also ready to accept some of the modern concepts. Through the film, I come to this conclusion. Why? Because you are also using, as I told you, very good metaphors. Say, for example, the elders are talking about love between Krishna and Radha, spiritual love, and the women folk, including Bulbul herself, hears their conversation. Next morning, the women are giving a commentary. Last night they were talking so and so. So why you are putting this scene? I thought that you are respecting cultural values at the same time. So it is up to us to make our own choice, to synthesize a kind of synthesization. That is why the women are not criticizing what the elders were talking about previous night. Okay, implicitly they are agreeing with the elders that even our Lord Krishna and Radha, they were always involved in love making, but that is a kind of spiritual love. So that is very important. Next, there is a scene where Bulbul's father is busy with his pig rearing business. And on the other side, one villager who is doing goat rearing. And he says that goat rearing is, even though it is not lucrative, it is a part of our culture. Pig rearing, yes, though it seems nasty, dirty, it is lucrative. That is a very nice metaphor. Goat rearing, we may understand that it stands for our cultural values. Even though it is not very much practical nowadays on day-to-day life. Pig rearing, even though it seems nasty, dirty, it is lucrative. It helps your survival. That is why I told you that when the other person says that goat rearing is more respectable because it is a part of our culture, Bulbul's father keeps silent. he keeps silent. He doesn't argue. There lies the point. Both sides, he's trying to get the merit of both sides. Then the another beauty is Bulbul also, I think two times, she fits the pick. Okay, personally getting into the dirt. So metaphorically, Bulbul, the so-called westernized, behaviors and all that, kissing and all that, in the eyes of some contemplative people, it may be look dirty or unacceptable. Okay, she's ready to accept it because of its value. So that is why I think you put Bulbul two times fitting the getting into the dirt, the pigs. That is the second sin. First Krishna Radha talking about, then pig and this one, God hearing. Another is Boni. Boni, while her mother is doing nail polishing, she says, I like pink color. Let me be allowed to use pink color, mother, next time. She doesn't argue. Her mother says that, no, red is finer, red is more beautiful, more attractive. Now, metaphorically, Boni doesn't argue her mother. She doesn't deny, no, I don't like it. I will never do that. Instead, she allows her mother to do what her mother's like, and she offers a choice that next time I'll be allowed to use pink color. So metaphorically, these youngsters, three of them, are ready to accept the merits of both sides, cultural values and modernist ideas. That is what I feel. Then, let me come to Bulbul, the main character. She joyfully participates in the religious festivals and all that. Okay, that also metaphorically, symbolically, she respects culture, our traditional culture. And there is one particular scene where her father asks her to sing a song before the guest. She happily obeys. She knows that she doesn't feel comfortable while singing. She's not a good singer. She knows that, but she obeys her father. That also symbolically, she respects culture. Bulbul's character.
Sorry to cut you short. That's a quite layer of observation you have given to us.
Let me come to.
We would love to have observation in form of an article. Yes. In the local newspaper, so that we can all read in a really elaborate way.
The last point, sir, if you allow me. Her mother first, she was bitterly crying, facing towards the window when that misfortune happens. Bitterly crying. But at the end of the story, she encourages Bulbul. Whenever you want to do something, whatever you want to do something, you do it, you listen to your heart's voice, what your heart tells you. So the transformation of mother when she heard the shocking news, she was bitterly crying. Then at the end of the story, she encourages. This also shows that you are not siding with any of these two ideological concepts, rather you are trying to strike a balance. That is what I feel. Last question, please, Rima. Bulbul is stitching something when she was talking to Suman. I'm not going to be your friend. Suman lives, okay. The stitching and all that, what is the cultural significance? Is there any cultural significance with her needlework? That's all. Something she was stitching or embroidery. Does it have any cultural significance, value in your Assamese culture? What anything what she was stitching?
Clothes.
Well, I was just asking, has it got to do with any cultural significance with Assam?
culture is
her needlework, stitching something. Simple cloth or something.
Culture. You can take it, you can interpret in a very different way,
okay.
Like in your own way. So it's a part of her life, day to day, you know, survival also. And
I see.
It is like it's some people they do it for survival, some people do it because they love to do it, and sometimes you have no other choice. So I don't know how it, like in every society I think they do this, right?
That sin is also very important. I think from that very sin, we come to know that Bulbuli is not going to compromise. Whatever the moral policing, the local youths trashing her
that
and all
is
that.
I kept it there in the film because, yes, after that scene, what is happening.
Yes, yes.
Just to show her inner struggle.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was the transformation.
Bulbul can sing. Bulbul can sing because Bonnie and the Bulbul, they are both friends. So in the film we can see that Bonnie is, she is a good singer, she sings well, and Bulbul is not, in the eyes of people, Bulbul is not good. But when it comes to life, when they both gone through that incident of moral policing, Bonnie, she took her life, but Bulbul survived. So maybe you cannot dance well or sing well, but she is singing the song of life. So that is how I decided to.
Yeah, can we move on to the next question, Sonia?
Yeah.
Thank you, Rima. We met yesterday also. Maybe I'm wearing mask, so you can't. My next question is, we are also very, very excited about your next film. Some says that, you know, Bulbul Can Sing is an extension of your village rock star. So I'm also curious to know the style and approach you're going to, you know, work on the next film. Are you also scared that it might become monotonous? So how, what new are you going to offer to all of us? We are all excited.
No, I'm not afraid that it will be monotonous because it doesn't work for me. I just have decided just I need to make movies whatever way possible. So Bulbul is a different from for me Bulbul is different from Village Rocksters, and this is a Village Rocksters sequel. So Dhunu, she is going to continue her journey, Dhunu, her mother and family. I don't know what I'm going to offer. I'm just that sir, he already mentioned he whatever he talked about my films. So I would without, you know, so that it doesn't affect me, the outer things. So I can be there the way he mentioned also, okay, it could have been that way if you shot that fight sequence with the cows could have been better or like that. So now when you are exposed, though, there are chances, you know, because I intentionally or like consciously or I don't know, like it affects me also. So in future also and now also whatever I'm making, I'd like to, you know, keep myself be more authentic with my characters in that space and that mood, and other things are not in my hand. Maybe when I make my films, I discuss with him, he will say something else, new things to me, okay. Then it's a process for me, you know, process for me. It's, I'm now making that Village Rocksters as well as a family drama, a small town family drama. And I keep asking myself, you know, it's, but I think it's better to be just go with the flow. So I just it would be great. I'll feel really good if you like, and you know, like maybe sometimes what happens, you might not enjoy the whole film, but if you like something, moments, then I'll be happy.
Okay, going with the flow, before we perhaps move to the last question, let me just announce happily that we have been joined by another strong storyteller from Meghalaya. Dominic Sangma is sitting quietly over there. Could I pass the mic with you? Say hello to everyone.
Hi, hi everyone. I think that was unnecessary.
this is absolutely necessary.
I wanted to listen to Rima because I really love her film. You know, I'm really inspired by Rima.
I love your film.
That's what we want to hear from you.
Yeah. So yeah, maybe I can say like in front of everyone what I watched Velas Rockstar for the first time. I was so moved by the authenticity of Rima's observation of life, you know, the details that she could observe. And sometimes, I also get to hear lots of people saying that, you know, because she comes from village, so she shoot like this and all, you know. But then lots of us come from village.
Yes, right.
We still
right.
don't get that authenticity of that film. And I'm so, I always look up to Rima. I think that's what I want to say.
Thank you.
Wonderful. That's really wonderful. Can we have the last question, if we don't have time, I'm afraid.
You can have another
10
minutes.
Okay, if you allow. Yes, Waza, please.
And sir, and thank you for your interpretation. You such closely observed my film. And I also don't know what is wrong, what is right. I just go with my feelings. If it is naturally comes to me, I just accept personally in my life. So sometimes I am also wondering what is traditionally, you know, correct or wrong. I really don't know sometimes. I keep asking me question. But I take it what is natural. If I feel good, if you I'm eating also something, if I feel good, I eat. If I don't feel, I don't eat. It just that simple for me. But I'm really I'm thanking you that for your observation.
Yes, and we at the same time we are also expecting a write-up from Oza. If you would please write something on this film and share with us over the local newspapers, it would be a food for thought for all of us. Yeah, Oza.
Yes. One thing that I was also amazed yesterday, you know, the way you have ended your film, and the title of the film, Bulbul Can Sing, and at the end, you know, how her hair is being taken care of. It's amazing because it's such a non-conclusive ending of a film. It's like your Village Rockstar. It was a kind of a wish fulfillment, you know, little predictable, you know. So when I see the mother is entering into the village with the guitar, you know, But here it's something, it transcends to some other plane. You don't conclude, you know, but it's deeply, deeply, you know, immediately you can feel that, yes, possibly this is the time Bulbul should gain some kind of a strength, you know, even more. I expect that Bulbul will be really, will be slowly, slowly absorbing everything and take it forward for herself, you know. So it is a wonderful title, and the way film ends, it's really remarkably amazing, you know. That's
Thank
what
you.
I want to share.
Thank you. I always because myself I feel that life is unconventional, and you know, then we don't know what is going to happen next. So when I make my films, then also I don't like a, you know, definite ending, or so I always look for it and keep myself open to possibilities. So for Bulbul also, from the beginning I was thinking like where it is heading, where I'm going to end the film, and that was just a scene. Actually I was there, I thought I just wanted to show their bonding now, how developing. It's not, if sometimes you are not getting something from your own mother, maybe from family, but it doesn't matter if that blood also relation always helps.
In absence of bonding,
yes.
Bonding,
yes. So it was a simple actually scene, but when I was there, unexpectedly the weather changed and it was stormy. Then I started shooting. Then I thought that it's going to rain, and we were just middle of that Brahmaputra, you know, and we're wondering, like, if it rains, we don't even have an umbrella. We were in an open, like, small boat, but it didn't rain. And that storm also, it stopped, and I saw that rainbow, and a beautiful rainbow. And so everything at that particular time improvised, you know. She's tying her hair, then she said that it's getting damaged and take care. So these were not written earlier. So at that, within that period, like that 30 minutes of window, that is the time, because when I shoot in natural light in the morning and afternoon, like the sunset and sunrises, you get just 20-30 minutes window. So that is the very actually difficult time, and look at everything, like getting to the mood, and within that window, and the magic happened. And when I just finished everything, then from my home, it was 20-30 minutes drive. Then I just, this is the ending, you know. This is the ending. I had it like big smile. Oh, this is the ending of my film. Okay. So, yes, that's how it happened. So yes, that's beautiful. Actually, I always look for that magic. That's the moment I enjoy, and that always I look for that. Although I write and a bit structured, but I always look for that unexpected magic. Yeah, and that's beautiful, I think.
And perhaps it will remain with us for a very long time in our memory, in our consciousness. Let me share a small personal experience with cinema. Before the pandemic, we had screening of Tunisia films, if so, you may remember, in this auditorium. One film has remained in my heart and mind. It says, in a particular scene, it says, "Truth falls from the sky. Truth falls from the sky and fell scattered on the ground. And each one of us holds the peace into our heart and thinks that we have the whole truth. Each one of us hold that piece, small piece of truth, and thinks that we have the whole truth." And adding to that, let me share a master filmmaker, Michel Haneke, sir, the Austrian filmmaker. He said, "Cinema is 24 lies per second, L-I-E-S, lies per second, in the service of truth." One might not agree, one might agree, but with that note, Rima's work shall remain with us in our heart and mind. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you, the wonderful audience. Thank you.
My pleasure. It's like wonderful. And being with you, honestly, last the whole year, I'm making movie. But I'm not very much enjoying the process. Some not that lack of motivation. I don't know, like, it's blocked. Like, I just visited, I was in Kerala for 7 days for a wellness program, like to do meditation, yoga. So here, yesterday also I was speaking to Bolo, that today I'm feeling like again, you know, alive to be with you all and to be here. So whatever you are giving me, I think I'm grateful, honestly. Like, I feel alive again, and I'm really thankful to everyone. Thank you.